About 7 years ago, my two colleagues and I, we had a chance of meeting with this batik legend, the one of the most famous batik designers of the country. And we're telling him that we able to create batik patterns using fractal, mathematical, and that running in a computer. As naive as we were, because we are happy to have this chance to meet him, and we're kind of hope that he will support us. Of course, he will be excited that we doing new things about batik, but turn out he hated it. He hated the idea of combining traditional batik with technology. He looked at our laptop and our batik samples as if there is a bad smells in the room, and he said, "Batik and technology should not come together." And he ended our presentation by saying that what we're doing is a blasphemy. It's an insult to batik as a sacred culture. So what is batik anyway? The practice to hand drawing specific pattern from your mind to a specific cloth has a long history in Indonesia, but batik is not originally come from Indonesia. The practice can be traced back to more than 2,000 years ago, back in Egypt, and it was entering Indonesia in the era of Majapahit and Sriwijaya Kingdom. Traditionally, a traditional way to create batik was directly to hand draw the specific image to a piece of cloth using a tool named canting. It fills with a hot liquid wax, and you will dye it with resist dye technique. This is the traditional way of creating batik. It takes months or even years to finish, and it will produce one-of-a-kind batik. Batik traders, batik designers, batik merchants, usually they draw the specific pattern, the batik patterns, on a piece of paper. After that, they keep it, and they will use it to reproduce another batik. But what's the problem with this practice is they will keep producing the same batik pattern over years. So we see the same kind of like, yeah, similar batik patterns everywhere. And slowly, of course, this art, this ancient art, are abandoned, especially by the younger generation. It's so uncool, it's strict with rules, it's very traditional, it's so long to do, and well, the younger generation now, they didn't know exactly what is batik. So how batik can survive in this present art of Indonesia, where we have now technology in every aspect of our life? How batik can survive? This is where I think technology can be solution. What if a set of fractal mathematical based on Mandelbrot and Lindenmayer system that we use can create batik pattern? What if a computer can take over the design process? Most importantly, what if the younger generation now can define their own batik and can improve their own batik? Back in 2007, me and my two colleagues found that fractal can create batik patterns. While none of us has any batik expertise before, because while I studied communication science in college, the other two guys are mathematician and an architect. So I think creating batik with fractal was accumulation of our experience as Indonesian, where batik has really rooted in our culture and the things that we are studying in back in college. So we think that it really be cool if everybody can use software, can use an app to learn about batik, and fractal can actually create patterns of batik in short of time. So if you use our software, the pattern can be changed by tiny change of one parameter. So if you change another parameter, it will change the image. If you click another parameter, it will change the image. So we can get various pattern in short period of time. We had a chance Then we thinking about, oh, it would be cool if we have a chance to try this out to few of our friends. Firstly, we invited a few of our designers' friends to use it. And we said, hey, we have this software that can create batik pattern with a fractal mathematical. And they said, oh, cool, can we try it? And yes, so we got good feedback. And finally, the most important thing is we are finally able to meet the traditional batik artisans to try our software. And of course, it wasn't easy at first because they are already used to the traditional method of doing batik. But what kept us going was their persistence to learn about this technology, despite they never see a computer before in their life. And they learn how to use this technology to improve their craft. And that's overwhelming for us. So we keep perfecting the software, and all the batik artisans actually prove to us that our technology improved their craft. Plenty of younger and older generation create the batik pattern using old batik pattern to create new pattern. Or they're creating new, completely new modern batik pattern like this skull. It's very popular right now. It's actually sayap burung, it's a feather of a bird and everything, but it looks super modern right now. Currently, we've been training for more than 1,000 batik artisans in all Indonesia. We have to come to their villages hands-on and directly train them to use our software because they cannot afford to go to Bandung where we have our workshop. And we're very happy to see this younger and older generation collaborate each other, and not only to preserve batik as cultural icon, but also to support the industry that support millions of batik artisans, traditional batik artisans in Indonesia. This way, I see that technology allow the younger generation to define their own batik, allow them to preserve their batik, and technology has bridging batik from the past to the future. And of course, technology has proved that it will improve our ancient art and live and let batik live in the modern era. At the end of the day, we're happy we never listened to anyone that said that batik and technology should not come together, even if he was a batik legend. Thank you.